Good morning, and welcome to all, both those who are here in person and those who are joining us online, as we gather on the fifth Sunday after Epiphany, a time in the church year when we reflect on the ways in which God appears to us through the Spirit of Christ. We will also celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion this morning. Please fill out the fellowship pads so that we might better respond to the needs of those who are in attendance this morning and so that we might follow up with those who are visitors among us. Our thanks for the altar flowers, which beautify the sanctuary this morning. And my thanks to the worship team, which coordinates these services, and to the musicians who do so much to offer inspiration for our service of worship. Our soloist this morning is Carolyn Jackson. Our liturgist this morning is Louise Wheeler. You are invited to share in coffee fellowship following today's service of worship. And yes, we do have Congdon's donuts, so. I would like to remind everyone that there is now a prayer book at the entrance of the church for those who would like to include prayer requests during the joys and concerns. I would ask that one of the ushers bring the prayer book up during the first hymn, so that I can share any prayers with the congregation. In an effort to more fully connect with the community and to provide another opportunity for fellowship, we will be offering a new initiative called Lunch Bunch, easy to remember, which will meet this coming Wednesday, February 8th at 12 noon at For the Love of Food and Drink at Saltwater Farm. We're going to check with them to make sure that all is well because they had pipes that burst, so hopefully they will be open. If not, we'll have a plan B. This will be an informal gathering to grab a bite to eat, catch up with one another, and maybe say hello to the owners, Wendy and Bill, who have been so gracious to our church over the years. I also have an exciting news that we have something of a sports celebrity in our midst, that A.J. Medvano has been named Athlete of the Month at Wells High School. So and we attended Regan's last game the other day, and she's fierce. You know, she don't mess with her. But she did wonderfully as well, and you know, really plays with a great deal of passion, and you know, played a lot of the game. So we got two great athletes, not only in our church, but in our confirmation class. So our congratulations to both of you. Couple of reminders, confirmation class is in fact meeting after church, and say a prayer because we're gonna try to have a showing of Godspell. How many of you have seen Godspell? Yeah. As we've been talking about, you know, Bible stories and going through the confirmation book, I keep referring back with the confirmation class of the way in which those stories are portrayed in Godspell, the parables and the sayings of Jesus and the stories. And so the thought occurred to us that maybe it would be fun to actually watch it. So with AJ's help, we set up a fire stick. I'm still learning. So that we're able to get other channels on our TV. And so if all goes well, we'll be watching. So anyone is welcome to join us after church. We'll be in front of the TV in that corner. So on Monday, we'll have coffee with friends at 10 o'clock, diaconate at 7 o'clock, and the diaconate meeting will be Zoom this month. Right. Zoom meeting this month, next month, the plan is to be in person. And then choir rehearsal is also at 7. Tuesday at 12:45 is staff. Wednesday, as we indicated, at 12 noon at For the Love of Food and Drink at Stillwater Farm is Lunch Bunch. Ladies Benevolent Society meets Thursday at 11 o'clock. And next Sunday, a long-awaited event, we will be doing the AED training at 11 o'clock shortly, pretty much grab a cup of coffee and we'll go right into the training at 11 o'clock. Someone from the fire station will be leading this training. And it will be a good opportunity. I think there's six or eight of us who will be participating. It would be good to have people in the congregation to know how to use that. Hopefully we never will need to, but in the event that we did need to use it, we'll have people in the congregation who are trained to use it correctly. Again, that's next Sunday at 11 o'clock after the service of worship. And you may have seen on Facebook that we have another all-church family event coming up, a popular event from years past, the all-church birthday party, where, as you recall, there'll be 12 tables set up and with 12 different birthday cakes for each month of the year. And my understanding is that you can rotate or do it as a kind of a buffet. So anyways, it's a lot of fun. And there's a sign-up sheet in Fellowship Hall. It's going to happen on March 12th after the service of worship. So this is something that we all loved before the pandemic and looking forward to starting up again now that things are opening up. So March 12th after worship, if you're able to be here, sign up in Fellowship Hall. I think that's all the announcements that I have. Let us join together now in passing the peace in any way that's comfortable for you. All right, so this morning you'll hear a scripture when Jesus talks about salt. Now, I tend to use salt fairly often. In fact, a lot of mornings I'll make hot oatmeal, and sometimes Deb will say to me, so you're having a little oatmeal with your salt? You know, so I tend to like salt my oatmeal. So I brought this salt in to help us think about what Jesus is saying about salt this morning. What do we use salt for? To add flavor to food. We put it on eggs. We put it on corn in the cob in the summer. We put it on popcorn. Like I said, we put it in oatmeal. And I'm sure there's lots of other ways that you use salt as well. But if salt loses its flavor, it doesn't do much to add to the taste of the food that we put it with. It really no longer fulfills its purpose. Then Jesus talked about light. And, you know, we all have lights. In fact, we have lights with our cell phone. Being that this is a new cell phone, you know, we have a light, and this has a lot of purposes too. It helps us to see if we're working on something, like working on the car, to see what we're doing. Helps us to find our way in dark places, like when we're in the basement, making sure there's no more water. And it helps you to read things that are small. So now I have to turn it off so I don't destroy the battery. there we go. Yep, we're off. But if the light goes out, it's not real helpful and doesn't fulfill its purpose. I think what Jesus is saying is that when we call ourselves Christians, we need to have some basic qualities. We need to be a follower of Jesus and follow Jesus' teachings. We need to be loving and gracious, and we need to trust in God. And I think what he's saying is that just as salt and light have basic qualities, so do Christians. So I think that's what he's saying to us in our passage this morning.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. If the human body, body of blood and muscle, is to live, it needs salt. If the body of Christ, body of peace and justice, is to live, it needs us. If the earthly creation, bustling and blooming, is to flourish, it needs the sun's light. If the new creation that you are in Christ is to flourish, it needs the Spirit's light. Jesus says, "We are the salt of the earth, light of the world. Our faith, our love, our hope, essential as salt and light." Please join together in our opening hymn, number 580. Let us join together in our opening prayer. God of mystery and judgment, who has made us to be salt and light in a tasteless, shadowed world, guide us in this time of worship. Grant us understanding and spiritual discernment so that others may see your good works through us, give you the glory, and be moved to serve you. Amen.
As we share in our joys and concerns, I would like to once again express my thanks to all those who are calling or keeping in touch in various ways with members and friends of the church family. The chair of our care team, Judy Ryan, has asked me to share the following joys and concerns. Prayers for Lenora and Jack. Jack has been hospitalized recently and is now at home with hospice care, surrounded by his family. Lenora is a longtime member of the Ladies Benevolent Society. Cindy asked for prayers for Alyssa, who is recovering from a fall and broken ankle. Sandy asked for prayers for Carla, who has been diagnosed with MS. Mary asked for prayers for Diana, who is dealing with various health issues. Diana was a kindergarten teacher in Wells for many years before her retirement. Prayers for all those dealing with COVID and other viruses. Prayerfully, everyone will return to good health in the very near future. Ongoing prayers for Jenny, Sandy, Elizabeth, Christine, Gloria, Mike, Reese, Bill, Gary, Kathy, Ted, Reverend Peter, Lorianne, Susan, and Kim. We also pray for Jackie and Tommy, for Pam, for Emily, for Cindy, for Marriott, for Marcia and Robert, and Bobby. There are many in our circle of church family and friends who continue to mourn the loss of loved ones. May they know that they are in our prayers. Every thought is a prayer, and everyone is appreciated. Let us join now in our pastoral prayer. God of loving grace, your Son offers these words of challenge. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. Help us to be salt and light through the power of your Spirit working within us, so that we might fulfill your calling and your purpose in our lives. May it truly be said of us that they'll know that we are Christians by our love. God, we pray for the millions who are suffering from extreme weather. We especially pray for those who are suffering from the extreme cold that we are experiencing, and we give thanks for the warming centers that are providing warmth to those who are the most vulnerable to the frigid temperatures. Help us to find the strength to endure the bitter cold. As we offer these prayers before you, God, we also pray for those that we name in our joys and concerns. And we pray that you offer healing and strength and encouragement and hope to all. And now as we offer these prayers before you, God, let us also join for a moment of silence, remembering those concerns that lie deep within each one of our hearts. Let us pray. As we offer these prayers before you, God, let us also pray in the words that Jesus taught his disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you. begin to fall, you will hear the trumpet shout, "Awake the nations underground, looking to my God's right hand when the stars begin to fall." My Lord, what a morning. My Lord, what a morning. Oh, my Lord, what a morning when the stars begin to fall. You will hear the sinner cry to wake the nations underground, looking to my God's right hand when the stars begin to fall. My Lord, what a morning. Shout to wake the nations underground, looking to my God's right hand when the stars begin to fall. My Lord, what a morning.
Our scripture this morning is taken from Matthew 5, verses 13 through 20. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. For truly I say to you, until heaven and earth pass away, not an iota, not a dot will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever relaxes one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Blessed be upon these words.
Let us join together in prayer. God, we thank you for your Spirit, which dwells within us and empowers us to walk faithfully in your paths. Help us to know what we need to do to fulfill your calling in our lives. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. What are the essential qualities needed to be a Christian? How do we know when we are being a genuine and authentic follower of Jesus? Those are the questions that Jesus is addressing in our passage in Matthew this morning. He begins by saying that those who follow him are the salt of the earth. Now, in Jesus' day, salt was used to season incense and offerings to God. When salt became ritually unclean and could no longer be used for its assigned purpose, it had to be thrown out. Jesus went on to use this image to make the point that a follower who loses his faith is prevented from fulfilling God's purposes. But then Jesus goes on to up the ante. He says, "You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on the lampstand, and it gives light to the entire house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven." Jesus is calling his followers to be examples of righteous living, living out of the commandments of God, not because they have to, not because of an external law, but because of the love and compassion that dwells in their hearts because of their faith. Jesus, in short, is calling us to radiate the light of God through Christ that dwells within us, a light whose source is God's Spirit. Reverend Quinn Caldwell, one of the contributors of the United Church of Christ Still Speaking Daily Devotionals and chaplain of the Protestant Cooperative Ministry at Cornell University, where my son also works, helps us to better understand what Jesus is saying in today's passage. He describes his home church and how the most beautiful part of the church was the great Christ window over the rear balcony. Kindly face, outstretched arms, glowing, flowing robes. The beautiful window summed up the meaning of Christ for Caldwell. As beautiful as the Christ window was, however, it lost all its appeal when the sun went down. As the light would fade, so would Jesus' face. The window served as a metaphor for Caldwell about the ways in which Jesus is more or less visible in our lives, depending on the degree to which light shines through Christ. This church also has beautiful stained glass windows near the ceiling. If you look up around the six windows, up around the half circle windows, have a kind of a subtle, beautiful stained glass appearance to them. And they're truly beautiful right now during the day. And also, as you get towards sunset, the colors become even more visible. But when the sun sets, you can no longer see its beauty. And that's basically what Jesus is saying, that when the light of Christ sets within us, that you cannot see the light of Christ within us. So as you take a look at these beautiful windows, I would invite you to reflect on the possibility that these windows are a metaphor for the light of Christ, for our relationship with Jesus. Jesus tells his disciples, "You are the light of the world." And when the light of Christ shines through us, our light shines forth in a way that amplifies the beauty of Christ's spirit within us, as the light of the sun enables these windows to radiate their beauty. As is the case with those windows, we do not create the light, but reveal the way that the light can transform our lives and the lives of those around us. So what are some of the ways that the light of Christ shines through us as we live, as our lives might reflect the beauty of God's presence among us? Jesus offers one answer later in the text when he says to the disciples, "Let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven." Just as the light that comes through these windows isn't just for the sake of the windows, but so that others may see their beauty, so the light of Christ is given to us so that others may see the beauty of Christ shining within us. All of which is to say that we are called to bear witness to our faith in the living of our lives and to show the difference that the light of Christ makes in our lives. Sometimes we do this through words, as we share with others a powerful experience of Christ's presence in a particular event. How many times, as we share prayers with one another, do we speak about the ways in which we've experienced the presence of God through Christ in our midst, through a healing, through a joyful event, and even sometimes through challenging events as well? Other times, we reveal through our actions that we are doing what we are doing only because we believe it is what Jesus would want us to do. Revealing Christ's light in our lives can be hard, for we are often tempted to hide our light under the bushel basket, as Jesus put it, conceal our light for fear that sharing the light of Christ might offend someone or cause embarrassment. But unless people see Christ's light within our lives, they are far less likely to recognize that light within their own lives. There have been many people in my life who have been bearers of Christ's light over the years. But one in particular comes to mind. He joined our church in Connecticut after he moved to the area by IBM, which many employees say stands for "I've been moved." He had a great sense of humor and was a little bit of a scoundrel. But he loved Christ. He loved Christ's word. And he challenged the church and its leadership to follow his example. Because he let his light shine before others within the church, there was a significantly greater devotion to the richness of the Bible, and church programming was evaluated by its relationship to Christ's teachings. When he and his wife moved away, it was a huge loss for the church, but the light of Christ that he revealed in the living of his life continues to shine brightly in that congregation. We are indeed the light of the world when the light of Christ shines through us as the light shines through these windows. May that light transform our lives, our church community, and those that we touch as we seek to be bearers of that light to others. Let us join now in the sacrament of Holy Communion. Beloved in Christ, the gospel tells us that on the first day of the week, Jesus Christ was raised from death, appeared to Mary Magdalene, on that same day sat at the table with two disciples, and was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the joyful feast of the people of God. Men and women, youth and children, come from the east and west and north and south and gather around Christ's table. This table is for all who wish to know the presence of Christ and to share in the community of God's people. Let us join together in prayer. Eternal God, whose word is a lamp for our feet and a light for our path, we recognize and confess that we have failed to respond fully to your gracious presence in our lives. Through Jesus Christ, you have offered us new life, fulfillment, and the freedom to serve you. Yet we confess that we are captive to sin, that our sin binds us with false pride, and that the wrong that we do is made worse by the good we leave undone. Our hope is found in Scripture, where we are assured that anyone in Christ becomes a new person altogether. The past is finished and gone, and everything has become fresh and new. We give you thanks for the gift of Jesus, our only Savior, who is the way, the truth, and the life. In the fullness of time, you came to us and received our nature in the person of Jesus, who, in obedience to you, by suffering on the cross and being raised from the dead, delivered us from the way of sin and death. We praise you that Jesus now reigns with you in glory and ever lives to pray for us. We thank you for the Holy Spirit, which leads us into truth, defends us in adversity, and gathers us from every people to unite us in one holy church. We pray all this in Christ's name. Amen. On the night in which Jesus shared his last supper with his disciples, he took bread and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Take this in remembrance of me." Receive now the body of Christ. In like manner, Jesus took the cup and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all unto the remission of sins. Take this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Receive now the blood of Christ. Let us join now in a prayer of thanksgiving. We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of Jesus Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Let us join now in our communion hymn number 699, "Let Us Break Bread Together." Please rise.
Thank you.
Please be seated. And now, as we give thanks to God for enabling us to be salt and light to fulfill our purpose as we are called by Jesus to do, let us express our thanksgiving through our morning offering. God, from whom all blessings flow, praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly homes. Praise all grace of holy thrones. Let us pray. O God, please take these gifts and multiply them. Let them be a means to create the justice and peace you long for in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 670, O Word of God Incarnate.
Thank you.
Now let the mystery of God send us into the world as we seek to discern God's call to compassion and justice. Let the wisdom of God surprise us in the world. Let the salty, bright, and good glory of God shine through our work in the world. In the mystery, the wisdom, and the glory of God, amen.